Ahmed Rashid, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Of course, the headlines have moved far away from Afghanistan, and that's not to the advantage of the people living there. Tell me so far, to the extent that we can make any judgment, how you think the political situation on the ground in Afghanistan is playing out now that the Americans are well gone.
Well, I think there are enormous issues. The drought, the COVID, the virus, possible starvation, which the World Food Program is alerting people already that people could be starving in a matter of days or weeks. And the enormous reluctance of the Taliban to take on board what Western governments and the UN and other NGOs are suggesting, that they ease up on women, on education, and they show some compatibility with Western demands. The problem is that the Taliban ruled, but they did not govern. By the time the Americans went to war with the Taliban and Osama bin Laden, the Taliban were already hugely discredited and generally rendered hopeless by the Afghan population who had fled. And we seem to be repeating that whole scenario once again. And I think it's incredibly important now that the West should differentiate between recognition, which should not be on the cards for the time being, and actually supporting the food crisis and preventing millions of Afghans from starving to death.
Now, is there a mechanism? I mean, we know that the Americans have frozen billions of dollars of Taliban assets. Is there a mechanism that is credible that would allow for humanitarian aid at the scale that we're talking about is necessary, that would not go through the Taliban government, that would not be siphoned away or stolen by officials that we can't trust?
I don't see that $9 billion that is lying in U.S. accounts is unlikely to be freed. And I'm sure they're very complicated methodology which will be needed to free it. Instead, what you're looking at potentially is fresh money from donors who could provide it to the UN to buy food. Now, of course, there are all sorts of other things involved. We need desperately need medical aid, Westerners need to be able to come and go freely from Afghanistan in order to run this aid program. There's been no hint of any of this so far, and we don't seem to have an American strategy or a policy towards how the Americans are going to react towards this humanitarian crisis.
You know, you wrote the book on the Taliban back in 2000, known worldwide. If you were writing that book again today, have they changed?
Well, you know, unfortunately, again, we fall back on this issue of governance. We thought for a long time that the Taliban would be educating and training their younger generation to become bureaucrats and handlers of civil society. But we were wrong. There are a lot of cosmetic changes, such as they use iPhones, they can take pictures, which of course was photography was banned in the earlier Taliban government. We don't have a Taliban policy as to what they want to do regarding all these very sensitive issues which people are walking around, tiptoeing around, and not wanting to face up to a Taliban decree which will ban this newspaper or that television station. The other thing, of course, is the factionalism within the Taliban. And for the time being, it seems, although it's very difficult to decipher exactly what's happening, but it certainly seems that the hardliners in the Taliban who don't want to make changes in their style of government or in their ideology, they're winning out at the moment. And leading the pack there are the Haqqanis. There are two Haqqanis in the cabinet, two more minor officials in the cabinet, and they are, I presume, thinking of their own future. They've got a $10 million reward for their capture or death from the Americans. They are very confident because they seem to have wrapped any kind of voices of moderation from the Taliban on the knuckles. And they seem to be now basically running the show. And so it's very difficult for Western governments also to deal with the issues of factionalism and division and who's on top now, who's not on top now. And the failure really to cultivate in all the months of negotiation in Qatar, the failure to cultivate a more moderate Taliban.
Can we at the very least say that the Taliban for now are still in charge of the whole country? Or do you start to see real chaos in terms of different, like in the north, for example, where it would be very hard for them to be able to impose authority, where you're starting to see just lawlessness emerge again?
Well, I think, again, it all depends on whether humanitarian relief is going to reach the Afghan civilian population. If it just reaches the elite in the cities and just reaches the Taliban military machine and ignores the public, there will be two results. One, there'll be a massive walkout of the public as refugees in neighboring Iran, Pakistan, even Central Asia. And that would probably be stopped because both Iran and Pakistan right now are bankrupt, basically. They have said very categorically that we cannot accept any large numbers of refugees. And that's, you know, very much, we've seen the situation in Europe, how it's getting back to us. Many Afghans having reached Eastern Europe, going through Iran and Turkey. Nobody's in the mood to have another influx of refugees coming in from Afghanistan, no matter how bad the pictures of suffering we see on the TV. Remember that the refugee crisis is acute because Iran and Pakistan are still holding refugees from the Soviet period. Not counting those refugees who fled the first Taliban government 20 years ago and subsequent fighting.
So this is a matter of the next few months. I mean, assuming that this continues to play out as it has since the withdrawal, winter, we're going to see both domestic implosion and a very significant refugee flows out of this country.
You have a situation where armed resistance on the ground has petered out for the time being. But I would say, you use the word chaos, I would say there's enormous unrest at the moment, I think, even in the cities regarding the woman. I mean, women have been coming out almost every day. Women are facing enormous challenges because they have to get their jobs back. And they are the earners of families in many instances. So I think we are going to see a lot of unrest, and it's going to be much more easy for the opposition to organize unrest in the cities, demanding food and demanding, services for the population. And certainly the Taliban are going to use probably harsher and harsher methods to deal with that. And that, of course, will create its own snowballing crisis.
These women that are in an absolutely parlous state, that are willing to, you know, effectively throw their lives in danger to get their message out, and we're hearing it. But at the other hand, the Taliban government allowing it to persist, I mean, in ways that certainly wouldn't have happened when you wrote your book. And I'm wondering why you think that is.
Well, certainly the Taliban have not resumed beating women savagely in the streets the way they did back in 2000 when they took Kabul. And any hint of any kind of protest would lead to always an automatic harsh treatment of women and anyone else who was protesting. That may not be happening, but what I'm trying to say is that as hunger increases, unrest increases, more people, not just women, but men and families, and come out onto the streets demanding wheat. If you've seen some of the wheat that has come in from Iran and Pakistan being distributed, it's horrific scenes of people just throwing themselves at the truck, you know, trying to get a bag of wheat out. And scenes like that are going to multiply. And, you know, I do think it's very important that the Americans develop some kind of strategy as to how to deal with this situation.
And but before we close, talk to me just a little bit about what you think ISIS and other terrorist organizations' capabilities and intentions are as it stands right now in Afghanistan.
There are multiple terrorist groups active in Afghanistan. And the truth of the matter is that they have been fighting with the Taliban against the enemies and against the Americans. And these groups who are from Central Asia, Pakistan, have been extremely active and helpful to the Taliban. Many of them are living along the border with Pakistan. Now, for me, the real issue is it's very easy for the world to say, well, the Taliban have to stop all these terrorist groups. Well, the first issue is, do they want to stop these terrorist groups? Because these terrorist groups are their allies. They've been their allies in the fight against the Americans. And if they suddenly tell these groups to stop it, go home, go retire, whatever, there's a big chance that these groups will turn against the Taliban, just like ISIS has turned against the Taliban. So that's the first, I think, really important issue. And secondly, what do the Taliban do with these people? Even if they would be willing to wrap them up, what do they do? Do they kill them? Do they put them in jail? Do they punish them? Do they send them back to their own home countries, which of course would create, any one of these steps would create acute problems for the Taliban and acute problems for the international community. Because there's no sort of guideline as to, I mean, Afghanistan is basically occupied by large numbers of terrorist groups.
Well, Ahmed Mashid, we didn't resolve it. Not that I thought we were going to, but I really appreciate you joining us today. And I know that you've made us all a little bit smarter on what's happening on the ground.
Thank you.